Here we're going to discuss the inverse sine and inverse cosine functions. So I'd like you to first please review the video inverse functions. So that's a video in algebra, but it applies to what we're doing here in trig. So the first thing I notice about the sine function graphed here is that it's periodic. Now what's important about a periodic function, or one aspect of it, is that the output, that is the y-coordinates, repeat, right? So in that case, it, what we say, fails the horizontal line test. So fails the horizontal line test. And all we mean by that is that when you draw a horizontal line, it intersects the curve more than once. Now the consequence of failing the horizontal line test is that the function is not one-to-one, okay? Now, to be able to create an inverse, you need a one-to-one function. So functions that are not one-to-one, right, that implies, this little symbol means implies, that there's no inverse function. Now this function sine, of course, has a domain of negative infinity to infinity and a range from negative 1 to 1. And unfortunately, this function sine with this domain and this range does not have an inverse because it fails the, well, because it's not 1 to 1. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this function and we're going to restrict the domain. Okay, we're not going to take the domain to be negative infinity to infinity anymore. And we want to restrict the domain in such a way such that two things are satisfied. So let's call this sine restricted. So sine restricted, just so we know that it's not plain old sine. So the domain is going to be restricted such that two properties are satisfied. The first one is this, that the function is 1 to 1, okay? So we want to limit the domain such that we get a function that is 1 to 1. The second condition is we still want the range to be negative 1 to 1. So we still want the range to be negative 1 to 1. The question is, how should we restrict the domain? Now, it turns out there are infinite ways of doing this, but what we're going to do is we're going to say, hey, let's just take the portion of sine just from negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. That is, sine restricted is going to have a domain of negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. Now, this function right here is no longer sine. It's sine restricted, okay? And here's the graph of sine restricted. It's basically just the graph from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2 of regular sine, right? It's just this part of the wave. Notice that the range of this is negative 1 to 1, and also the function is now 1 to 1, right? It passes the horizontal line test. And what that means is that this function, that is sine restricted, has an inverse. So this function is 1 to 1, and that implies it has an inverse. That's why we did this restriction, okay? Now the question is, how do you find the inverse? And just like in the video inverse functions, what we first do is we write the function that we have, which is f of x equals sine x, and we know it's restricted sine. And then we write y is equal to sine x, and then you switch, that is, you switch the x and y, so you get x equals sine of y, and then you solve this equation for y. Now, we don't have an algebraic way of doing this, so what we do is we invent a notation, and here's our invention. We just write this, y equals inverse sine of x, okay? These two notations, they mean the same thing. These are logically equivalent, but this has the advantage that y is isolated. And then the last thing we do is we replace the f of x with f inverse, okay? And this is the inverse function. So this is inverse sine. Now the important thing to note about inverse sine is that the most important thing about it is its domain and its range. Now the domain, right, of the inverse is always the range of the original. So the range of the original was negative 1 to 1. So the domain of this inverse function is negative 1 to 1. And then here's the critical part, or the second critical part, I should say. The range of this function is the domain of the function that you started with. So the range of inverse sine is this, negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2, okay? And so here's our inverse function, inverse sine. And remember, it's the inverse of restricted sine. Now we can also, before we go ahead and work with this a little more, We can also put the graph of this up here and see how it compares to regular sine. So this point, of course, has coordinates x is pi over 2 and y is 1. And this point has coordinates x is negative pi over 2 and y is negative 1, right? Now that means that the inverse, right, the inverse is the function with these ordered pairs switched. So it's going to have x is 1, y is pi over 2, so maybe up here. So it's going to have, if this is 1, x is 1, y is pi over 2, right? So this point up here is going to be 1 comma pi over 2. And likewise down here, instead of negative pi over 2, negative 1, we're going to have negative 1 and negative pi over 2. Okay, so we're going to have this point there. So the inverse function is going to look like this. Instead of sort of half a part of a wave on its side, it's going to be part of a wave like this, okay? Let's graph that in now. Okay, so this is the graph of inverse sine. It looks like sort of a half of a wave, but on its side, right? And it's the mirror reflection of restricted sine. So remember, mirror reflection, it's the mirror reflection across the line y is equal to x. That's always true of a function and its inverse. Okay, so the important thing is this, right? And remember, its domain is negative 1 to 1, and probably the most important thing is that its range is from negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. Let's see an example of how to evaluate inverse sine. Let's do that now. Okay, let's say you wanted to find inverse sine of 1 half. So first of all, I'm allowed to plug in any number between negative 1 and 1, and 1 half is in that interval, negative 1 to 1. So I'm allowed to plug in 1 half. Now, remember the range, right? What comes out of inverse sine is an angle between negative pi over 2 and positive pi over 2. So what we often do is we write this, inverse sine of something, in this case 1 half, it gives me an angle. So what we can do is we can write that, you know, we're looking for the angle such that sine of the angle is 1 half. So we often write this, sine of the angle that we're looking for, let me write sine of theta, is equal to 1 half. That's the game we're playing, right? When you write that this is equal to an angle, then what has to be true is sine of that angle has to be whatever is here. Now, the second condition, of course, is that the angle, theta, must be between positive pi over 2 and negative pi over 2. So when I think of that, right, here's negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. It's got to be in one of these quadrants, and I need the angle such that sine of the angle is 1 half. Well, that's going to be here, right? That's going to be this angle, which is pi over 6. So what I find is that inverse sine of 1 half is pi over 6, because sine of pi over 6 is 1 half, and pi over 6 lies in the range, that is, in the interval negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2. Now we can play the same game with cosine, right? Let's do that now. So here's the graph of cosine. Now, of course, cosine is not 1 to 1, right? So it's not 1 to 1. And that implies that there's no inverse function for plain old cosine. So the domain of cosine, right? So for cosine, the domain is negative infinity to infinity, and the range is negative 1 to 1. Now the question is, can we restrict cosine, right? So let's write this down here. So we want not just cosine, but restricted cosine. And restricted in such a way such that the function is 1 to 1, but also we don't lose anything in the range. So what should that restriction be? What should be the domain of restricted cosine? Now remember, we want the range. We still want to pick up all the values in the range, negative 1 to 1. Well, notice here the restriction from negative pi over 2 to positive pi over 2 that we used for sine isn't going to work. And the reason is because that little graph right here, it's not 1 to 1, right? This would not pass the horizontal line test. So let me ask you, when you look at this graph, can you think of a good restriction such that you still get the full range, negative 1 to 1, but that the function is 1 to 1 upon that restriction? Yeah, right? It'd be from 0 to pi, because from 0 to pi, well, you get all the values between negative 1 and 1, but that portion of the curve right here, that portion is one-to-one. That is, it passes the horizontal line test. And so that's the graph I'm talking about here. So this isn't the graph of cosine anymore. This is the graph of restricted cosine. Okay? So this is the function we're interested in, and this is the function that's going to have an inverse. So yeah, the range of this function is negative 1 to 1, but the domain is from 0 to pi. Okay? So this function is 1 to 1, and that implies it has an inverse. And we're going to call that inverse inverse cosine. Let's go ahead and find it. Well, just like before, right? You write y is equal to cosine x, and then you switch x and y. X is cosine y. And then you write this. You write simply y is inverse cosine of x. Now, these two are logically equivalent, right? They mean the same thing. The only advantage is that here you have y isolated, and we replace it with inverse function notation. So the inverse of f is inverse cosine. And now, of course, it's important that we say what the domain and the range are, right? The domain is the range of the original, which is negative 1 to 1. And the range of inverse cosine is going to be from 0 to pi. And again, the critical part is this, that you realize that whatever comes out of inverse cosine is an angle between 0 and pi. That's the one thing, the most important thing to remember. Okay? And so why is that? Why is that? Where do we get that range from? The fact that we took the original cosine and we restricted it from 0 to pi so that it would be 1 to 1. Okay? And that led to the range for inverse cosine. Okay, so now let's go ahead and get an idea of how to work with inverse cosine like we did for inverse sine. Okay, so let's find inverse cosine of negative 1/2. So what I remember is that anytime I'm thinking of something that comes out of inverse cosine, right? So I'm plugging in negative 1/2, and I can do that, right? Because that's between negative 1 and 1, so that's okay. But whatever comes out, that is the output, is always an angle. Now the angle, what has to be true is that cosine of the angle is equal to whatever you've got here, in this case, negative 1/2. Now that's one part of the restriction. The other part, of course, is that the angle has to lie in the range, right? Well, what's the range of inverse cosine? What are the outputs? Well, they're all between 0 and pi. Okay? So whatever comes out of this has to be an angle from 0 to pi. Now 0 to pi is up here, right? So can you think of an angle between 0 and pi such that cosine of that angle is negative 1/2? Well, cosine is negative over here, right? So the angle we're talking about is going to be up here. So it's going to be this angle, like that. So cosine of that angle is negative 1/2, and that angle is between 0 and pi. And that's why inverse cosine of negative 1/2 is, this angle is 2 pi over 3. Okay, and we'll gain some more practice evaluating inverse trig functions in a future video. I just want to make one more remark about notation here that you'll see in different textbooks. So if you look at, you know, inverse sine, right, of x, now the output of that is an angle, right? Now angles in radians were defined to be the arc length divided by the radius, right? Now if r was equal to 1, then the measure of the angle is equal to the length of the arc, right? That is the arc length. Now the units here are different, but in magnitude they're the same. So this here is the arc length, right? And of course this is the angle in measured in radians. Now, the consequence of that is that what we see is that arc length and angle are intimately connected. Now, as we talked about, whatever comes out of this, right, that's an angle. So that's some angle. So what people often do is, because every time you're looking for, whenever you're looking for inverse sine of something, you're always looking for an angle, what people do is they write this. Inverse sine of something is the same as arc sine x, okay? And so this label arc is to remind you that you're looking for an angle because there's this close connection between the arc and the angle in radian measure. So these should tell you the same thing. That is, if you're looking for inverse sine of 1/2, right, that's the same as looking for the arc sine of 1/2. And in both cases, as we found, it's the angle pi over 6. In both cases, you're looking for an angle. Okay, so in future videos, we'll talk about the other inverse functions for the other four remaining trig functions. Until next time.